Good morning, church. Good morning. Awesome. Thank you, Jeff, for giving some announcements. I just learned some sign language. This means silenced. That's awesome. It's all good. I mean, I'm going to have my moments, too. So good luck, sign languaging for me. But it's great that you are here. We are in week two of Follow Me. And if this is your first week, that's not referring to me. All right, so Follow Me is Jesus, and he is worthy to be followed. If you were not here last week, I want to catch you up just a little bit of what we're talking about during this series. If you were here, you might have forgot what I shared, and that's okay. I studied up on this a little bit, that you had 50,000 thoughts a day, which means over the course of the last week, you've had 350,000 different thoughts. So the chance that maybe one thing, just one thing I said, trumped all the 349,999 other thoughts shows that the Lord must have gave you a true whammy, which is great. But let me catch us all up just a little bit of where we started last week. All right, we laid this foundation. And part of this foundation of Follow Me is that we are all disciples. That we are all following someone or something. So the question is, are you a disciple by influence? In other words, are the things around you, your surroundings, are those the things that are influencing you as a disciple? Or are you intentional in organizing yourself around the life of Jesus Christ? And so I threw out this challenge and begin looking at your life. Look at how am I influenced versus how am I intentional. Begin to shift towards the intentional. Then we looked at that part of the recipe of healthy disciple making involves three aspects. There's expectations, training, and practice. And so we unpack this idea that God has expectations of those of us who are Christ followers of what it means to be a disciple. But then we followed that up and said, you know, that we really need to be trained in how to actually live that out or be modeled. Someone has to be an example for you. And then, of course, you need to put it into practice, which is one of the hard things about coming up here just teaching is the reality is that we need to put these things into practice. We've got to make this a part of our lifestyle. So last week, I really kind of dived in on this whole idea of expectations. Right? I mean, that's really where I kind of camped out last Sunday. You can go on our website if you want and look at that message about what does God expect of us? Because today, in the next few weeks after this, we're going to be really looking more at the training and the practicing. Okay? But here's really where we're heading to. It's this idea, 1 John 2:6. It's the series verse that we have for this month. That is, if we claim to live in Christ, we must walk as Jesus walked. To help us unpack this a little bit, I want to introduce you to our friend, our guest, our snowman. All right, I'm calling him Glamour Shots, not because his name really is Glamour Shots. In fact, I can't even prove to you if it's a him or her, but regardless, the reason why we have this snowman up here is because he's going to help us understand the portrait of a disciple. Furthermore, as we unpack this series, the snowman's going to help us understand that what does it look like to fully engage in the mission of First Federated Church? I think the snowman is a perfect mascot, so to speak, a perfect mascot for us, because the ideas of a snowman run parallel with the ideas of a disciple. I mean, just think about it, that putting it together is a process. The more hands that are a part of it, the better it becomes. It starts small, but builds into something great, that it can be quite messy, right? That if you completely ignore it, it will just fall apart. Another thing about it is that you can shape and mold and uniquely design this, a snowman, like a disciple, and yet the overall understanding is the same, right? They all look different, but they resemble the greater picture. And so today, I really want to unpack this, this first invitation that Jesus gives us. In order to do so, I want to throw you a little bit of a snowball with this question that should be on the screen is, are we called to make disciples of non-Christians? Might have been on the screen, but that's okay, right? We're improvising. Are we called to disciple non-Christians? Well, you were raised or maybe taught, maybe self-taught, that Jesus at one point, he wakes up and he goes out and he recruits 12 men to come and follow him. Now we do know that Jesus did spend a night in prayer, and then that at some point during that time of prayer with his Father, or coming out of it, God the Father revealed to him 12 people whom he should call to come with him. And we could easily see that as, oh, maybe it was just strangers, and he just took a leap of faith, and Jesus called these 12 people who he had never met before to follow him. Now, we do know in Mark 3:14 that it says he appointed 12 that they might be with him and that he might send them out to preach. But if we go off of the assumption that Jesus recruited 12 strangers, then we're really left hanging, particularly for two reasons. One is that's just not really biblically accurate. But secondly, if that's the case, then how much less likely are we to be disciples who make disciples? I mean, I could never blame you for going out there and just finding 12 people you've not met before and say, hey, go and follow Jesus. Walk with me as we follow Jesus together. It just could not happen. But before there was Mark 3:14, there was John chapter 1. See, before there was follow me, there was an invitation that Jesus gave of come and see. And so I want to unpack this passage. There's a few verses in the book of John, the Gospel of John in chapter 1. If you want to turn there, we'll have it on the screen as well. To give you just a little bit of context for John chapter 1, I have to tell you that in the chronology of Jesus' life, this falls after his baptism and his 40 days in the wilderness. So he was just coming out of that, coming onto the scene of what we'd say his public ministry. And we come to the verses 35. And it says, the next day, again, John was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said, behold, the Lamb of God. The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus, referring to Philip and Andrew. Jesus turned and saw them following and said to him, what are you seeking? And they said to him, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying? He said to them, come and you will see. So they came and saw where he was staying, and they stayed with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. Now skip just a few verses to 43. It says, the next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, follow me. Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Nathanael said to him, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Philip said to him, come and see. He said, here what we have, Philip and Andrew, two guys who were extremely curious about this Jesus character, largely because John the Baptist said, look, the Lamb of God. And so they approach Jesus, and as they do, Jesus issues this interesting question. What are you seeking? Now, Philip and Andrew knew that this was not just going to be a stand-up meeting, right? This was going to take much longer than that. And so they asked Jesus, can we follow you back to your home? Can we meet with you? Can we spend significant amount of time together? And Jesus invites them to the house where he was staying. Now, you can just imagine the conversation that was taking place at this point, right? Several hours they're meeting together. And you have to imagine that Jesus was looking through the Old Testament, what would be the Hebrew Scriptures, right? And look at how everything was pointing
to him. And so Philip and Andrew, that they leave, convinced that, no, this isn't who we expected. This isn't just this son of Joseph. This isn't a rabbi like the other rabbis were used to being around. This is someone unique. They were discovering who Jesus really was. And now, regardless of how long we've been in the Christian faith, we have to be reminded that Jesus is our constant disciple maker. There is always more that we can discover about Jesus and from Jesus. We need to continue to thirst for this living water. One of the ways of which you can do that, to continue to discover who Jesus is, it was referenced earlier, but is to be part of what we're going through as a church, this Project 51 Bible reading plan. Right? You can grab one of these bookmarks out in the foyer area. And the reason why this is so good is because daily we are coming into the scriptures and finding Jesus through every page of the Bible. Regardless of how long we've been following Christ, we need to continue to subject ourselves and gain from the wisdom and knowledge of God's word. But it doesn't just stop there. All right, there's more to discover about Jesus than just Christian education or even the Bible itself, as important as those are. Right, I mean, I would encourage you, if you're looking to freshen up your walk with Jesus a little bit, write out meditations to God. Just thoughts that you're having. You know, another great thing is to pray out loud with other Christians. It's amazing what you'll discover about Jesus when we pray together. Certainly praising together, worshiping God through music. How about serving the underprivileged? Some would even say that by giving generously and joyfully, I discover more about who Jesus is. And so if you find yourself today plateaued spiritually, I would challenge you with this question of how can I further discover who Jesus is? Because here's the key, guys, is that the more we discover of Jesus, the more that we can mirror Jesus. Now, one of the best ways that we can mirror Jesus is this idea of provoking curiosity. It's kind of interesting that provoking curiosity. Jesus was the master of this. I mean, everywhere we get, if you really look through the gospel accounts, right, the writings about the life of Jesus, you find that things that he says, the things that he does, were causing people, even people far from God, to be curious. And one of the greatest things that he did in getting people to be curious was ask questions. Right, I mean, he always asked questions. The Gospels record Jesus being asked 187 questions. And yet he answers 3. But in return, he asks 307 questions, the questions that he were asked, which tells us one of the things that we can do when we're asked a spiritually related question is not just give a quick answer or a quick solution, to ask a question, to stir curiosity in their soul. So how curious of a person are you? I mean, here's what you can talk about on your drive home today. Is there anything about your life that would make an unsaved person curious? Would non-Christians be curious with the way that you live your life? One of the great resources I've read on this is this book, I Once Was Lost. Don Everts is the author, and what he does in this book is he explains what he calls thresholds, 5 thresholds of someone who is lost. That's Christian lingo, right? Someone who's apart from God, who's unsaved, and the steps that many take when to convert to Christianity, to become a follower of Jesus Christ. He shares the first one is that a person has to trust a Christian. And this isn't all the time, of course, but largely someone who's apart from God trusts a Christian. That begins their spiritual journey. And then because of that, they become curious. And then once they're curious, then become open to change. Now, this isn't everyone's story. It's may or may not be yours, but this actually aligns with my story. Now, if you're here last week, I told you a little bit of the intro to this story, but my come and see invitation lasted for a couple months when I was in college. It started with an invitation to come and be a part of what was called a Mark manuscript. Basically, we were digging into the book of Mark. I mean, just tearing it apart. And in doing so, I started discovering about things about Jesus I had never known as a youth. And that's where my curiosity started being perked. And then I noticed on my floor, my dorm, there were several people who were Christians. And I became very curious with the way that they interacted. And then came the epic come and see moment for me. And it was this retreat that I went to called the 1910 Retreat. I didn't really know what it was about going into. I figured it had something to do with Christian history. A Christian had invited me to this, right? And so I'm going to this weekend retreat thinking, I'm going to learn something fascinating about Christian history in the year 1910. But that really wasn't the case. You see, what 1910 reflected was a quote of Jesus that we can find in Luke 19:10. See, Luke 19:10 from Jesus' mouth says, I came to seek and save those who are lost. I came to seek and save those who are lost. I discovered this weekend that this isn't actually an evangelism training retreat. I'm just here to come and see. Everybody else is there to be trained in how to reach others. I mean, talk about low-hanging fruit, right? But by the time that weekend wrapped up, God had revealed to me my sin. He revealed to me what was separating me from a right relationship with him. And then he followed that up with understanding the gospel message, this idea, this truth that Jesus paid for my sin, that he was the sacrifice on my behalf. He paid the penalty for my sin, and I ate that up. I trusted my life in Christ that weekend. My come to see shifted into this second invitation we'll talk about next week. But here's what we must understand. Regardless if this is your story lines up with that or not, what we need to know about this first invitation of come and see is that the path of disciple making begins with non-Christians. The path of disciple making begins with non-Christians. See, one of the reasons that contemporary disciple making is not making new disciples is that churches are training and educating Christians. That we've neglected in churches to disciple non-Christians. I mean, there's churches everywhere that claim the Great Commission, but then just feed the Christians. I mean, how spiritually full can we get? I mean, how holy can our huddles be? I mean, when I read the Great Commission, here's what I read. Go and make disciples of all nations. That we are to baptize. That we are to teach people to obey. How can you do that? Who is that really referring to if it's not referring to people who have not been baptized, who are not obeying? Do you see what's broken with the American church? Right? That we have sectored off evangelism to be its own ministry instead of realizing that it's the first invitation of the disciple-making process. So, to help us with this a little bit, I'm hoping this graphic comes up. This is a tool that I use. It's called the Engel Scale. Can't get into it too much, but this is a powerful tool to help us realize the full scope of the disciple-making process. That there are many steps, basically. You could add some of your own based in this. But if you look at number 10, it's highlighted there, is the decision to surrender to Jesus, right? We're crossing the line from lost to found, from dark to light. There's other language that it's used in the scriptures, right? But before that are all these steps. If I was you, I would go home and I would pop this up on your computer, Ingalls scale, right? It's up there on the screen, and say, who do I know who needs this come and see? What's the next step in the come and see for that person? It's a process, right? See, come and see is an invitation to make disciples of non-Christians. I mean, that's where it starts, at least. I mean, that's where Jesus started. See, Jesus did not choose the honor roll students at the Talmud. Right? The Talmud is the Jewish school, right, where young boys would go to learn from rabbis with the hope that they would be chosen to be a rabbi themselves. But that's not who Jesus chose. He didn't choose the top of the class. In fact, he chose the dropouts. I mean, if you want to be very honest, he chose the boys who didn't make the cut and went off to learn their father's business. I mean, some were fishermen, we know. We know that one of them, at least, was this secular-minded tax collector, right? I mean, these were not the cream of the crop, but these were the people. They were the men. Among others, truly, not just as apostles, but other disciples, people he called to follow him, that he issued this come and see. Come and check it out. And he just invested and invited. Invested and invited. Perhaps you can think of things that you have previewed before, you know, having to go all in on something, right? I mean, think about Netflix. They give you a month free trial before you have to subscribe and start paying. Or maybe you want to go buy a car, and so you go to the lot, and they let you take that car home for 24 hours, 48 hours, take it for a spin. Or Costco. This one's dangerous, people, right? You go, and they always have these food samples. Uh-huh. I'm not an impulse buyer except when I go to Costco. They get me every time. I even learned that Animal Rescue League allows you to kind of test a pet before you officially adopt it, right? It lets you kind of check it out a little bit. I mean, this is common throughout our culture. Now, some of you may know that I'm an addict of Chick-fil-A, right? And here's something you may not know, is that for 4 years straight, I've camped out for 24 hours in a Chick-fil-A parking lot. I know. Addictions make you do strange, strange things. But where it started, where my love for Chick-fil-A started, was when the first one came into town. I happened to know the general manager, the owner that was going to be pioneering that first Chick-fil-A, and they invited Kelly and I to come and have this pre-opening dinner party that they were throwing, right? So we came, and they showed us this incredible customer service we've never seen before. We got to try a bunch of different foods that were on their menu. They even gave us a behind-the-scenes look at how they make their food, prepare it, including the lemonade, which was kind of cool. Love it. Right. And I came out of that, and I was hooked. See, they invested and invited me to come and see it as a potential customer, right? And now I've opened every Chick-fil-A in the Des Moines metro area. I've invested more money in them than any restaurant to date. You see, as valuable as a Chick-fil-A chicken sandwich is, the value of salvation to a non-Christian is obviously far, far greater. And so we need to invest in order to invite, and invite in order to invest. And so I want to give you a few investment principles, all right? We could go on and on. You have some of your own you can add, but here's just a few ways you can invest in some non-Christians. One is by paying it forward. In other words, it's to pass things along, things that you are learning. It's like Philip. It's like Andrew, right? After they come and hang out with Jesus, they go and they're going back and they're, what am I going to do with this, right? I mean, you could just see Philip running back home. After being out all night hanging out with Jesus, he runs home and he wants to tell his brother Nathaniel what he had discovered. You could just see this conversation playing out, right? I mean, Nathaniel is home waiting for Philip to arrive, wondering what in the world, where has he been? And Philip comes home like, Nathaniel, I found the one. Oh, so you were at a girl's house last night. No, I I can't find the right woman. I mean, God would have to send someone from heaven. Speaking of which, I think that actually happened, right? This guy, this Jesus, everything he's telling us points to him being the Messiah. You've got to come and see. See, much like Philip, when we gain things, when we are curious ourselves, we need to turn around and pass that along to other people. Some of you are parents or grandparents. How much are you passing along? How much are you paying it forward, what you are learning? Not just what you learned 20 years ago, but what you're learning right now. How much are we doing that to our kids and to our grandkids? You might also take frequent timeouts. I mean, here's the reality. We are all too busy to stop and make time for people who are not Christians, who don't align their worldview to ours, right? We will never really find that time unless it's a priority in our life, unless we see it as how we walk the walk of Jesus. If Jesus can find the time to hang out with unsaved people, I'm confident that you and I can do the same. So pay it forward. Share what you're learning, right? Take frequent timeouts to be with non-Christians. And another way you could do it is to open your home. See, this conversation that Philip and Andrew had with Jesus was because he willingly invited them into the house he was staying to have hours-long conversation. It completely wrecked them. It changed their life, and we have them to thank for that. He opened up his home. Here's what I'm going to tell you. Your home is the greatest evangelistic tool that you have today. It is. You need to see your home, regardless of the shape or the size of your home. Whatever you call home, it is the greatest evangelistic tool that you have. Do you know why? At least why I believe this. It's because you can invite 10 of your neighbors to church. Statistically speaking, 15% of people you invite will accept your invitation to come to church. 15%. That's not bad, all right? We should maybe try that a little bit. But I bet that if you invite your neighbors, 10 of your neighbors, to come over to your house to share a meal or have some coffee or cookies, I bet most of them will accept. And that's your invest and your invite. Someone who's done a great job of this, I've heard testimony of, is Adam and JC. And I'm going to ask them to come up here right now. And they need this mic, so it gives me a little, you a break from me. But here's why I'm bringing them up here. It's because Adam and JC have embodied what it means to just open up your home. To see your home and your neighborhood as not this daunting, oh, how can I, or I need to arms reach. No, but saying, I'm going to invite people in. I'm going to invest them. I'm just going to allow them to come and see, and I want them to tell a little bit of their story.
Good morning, Fed. So about 2 years ago, we moved into our home, and our biggest mission, or idea, I would say, reason, goal for it, was to just be on mission and to love those around us and to be Christ to those people around us, just showing them Jesus. And so fast forward to this past summer, I'm a stay-at-home mommy and wife, and Lincoln, our son, and I were having breakfast, and we were just praying for the Lord to just give us opportunity. We have one car, so our influence during the day is limited to where we can walk. So that's our neighbors. And so, Lord, just give us opportunity to be your light today, bring somebody to us. And so fast forward to that afternoon, and we're just playing in our living room and looking out the bay window, and we have a little neighbor boy named Dylan, and he lives at the end of the street. And Dylan loves to ride his bike up and down our street in the summer and the fall time. So this particular day, as Lincoln and I were looking out the window, we noticed that there were a few little boys who were surrounding Dylan on his bike. And they didn't live on our street, so they kind of looked like, Dylan's like a lone bird, and they kind of looked like, I don't know, they were being mean or naughty or trying to like take his bike or something. So I was like, oh, Lincoln, let's just go play with Dylan and make sure he's okay. And so we went outside and, hey, Dylan, are you okay? Oh, yeah, I'm good, Miss Stacy. And then all of a sudden, these little boys just surrounded Lincoln and I. And, oh, my gosh, is that your son? He's so cute. Can I play with him? Do you have a dog? Could I play with your dog? Like, just things like that little kids do. And so we brought our dog out, and we let them play with our dog and our son. And another thing that we had done when we moved into our house to be really intentional is those free little libraries that you can put in your yard. We thought that that would be a good idea because we live in the middle of it, like a melting pot of different cultures. And so our idea was that we would put a bunch of different Bibles in there that are different translations, and people could have scripture and wholesome literature for the little kids or whatever. So I said, oh, if you guys like books, you could go grab a book and you could take one home for your friends. And then I got, you know, went inside and got some little snacks for them and let them pick out their favorite treat. So by the time Adam got home from work, there was like 10 or 15 little kids running around our yard, playing with our kid, playing with our dog. It was a good surprise, but it was a good way to be Jesus. So that actually continued on through almost every day of the entire summer and the entire fall. We knew once school was over that we'd have pounds on our door and we'd have little kids coming to play with us. Saturdays were every couple of hours. Like, they were coming to see us. So another thing that we did to try to be intentional with these particular kiddos, they lived in the apartment complex a couple blocks away. So when we would go on walks at night as a family, we would walk by them there, and they would just swarm us, like, oh, Mr. Adam, can we race today, or can we push Lincoln in the stroller, or whatever the case may be. So we really got to know these kids by just investing some time, learning that many of them are one-parent homes, and their mommies are, they might see them in the morning, but really they go to school, and then they come home, and they might get to see their mommies, but their mommies work so far away that they're there all night by themselves, like to do whatever they want, to find dinner whenever they want, maybe to put their brothers and sisters to bed. And so we're so glad that God brought them to our house, and he afforded us that opportunity. So through this, we've gotten to teach and guide just common sense things that like 5 through 13 year olds need to know. Like, we're so glad that you trust Mr. Adam and Miss JC, but like, don't go into strangers' homes, because a lot of them haven't seen a home, and so they want to see what a house looks like. And so just teaching them, like, no, you can't go into a stranger's homes, like, we haven't met your mommy and daddy yet. Or don't pick up our dog poop and throw it at each other's face, like, that's not nice. Or just things like that. Like, if you don't get your favorite kind of pop today, don't, like, yell curse words at me and run away. Stuff like that they just don't know. Tangibly, we've gotten to use the money that, you know, Adam earns for our family to bless him with just fruit snacks. And for 15 kids, that adds up. That adds up every day for the fall and summer. Or our yard. Like, we don't allow them in our house because we haven't met their mommies and daddies, but allowing them to play in our yard or play with our dogs that we have, or even our child, like, that's a big deal. So those are ways that we've been able to bless them. But most importantly, spiritually, and just discipling them, we've gotten to, like, on one of those walks, we were walking home one day, and I don't know if this story is true or not, but they were telling me how one of their big brothers got shot in the apartments that are next to us. Awesome! God, where did you bring us? But nonetheless, they were telling us the story, and I had been praying, like, Lord, just give us opportunities to share the gospel. Like, we're sharing all these things, which are awesome, but we want to share your truth with them. And so they're telling us this story, and Miss JC, like, I'm so scared of dying, and I'm like, okay, God, thanks. Like, so we get to our front yard, and we sit down, and there's about 5 of them there today, or that day, and I get to share the whole gospel with these sweet kids, like from the Ten Commandments to the punishment to why we need Jesus. And then we just sit there in our yard for a little bit of time, and they're just asking all the questions that they can think of, and it was really sweet. And the really cool part of this, you guys, is, you know, we're not missionaries in another country, missionaries here, but all of these kids are little Ethiopian kids, which means that if any of these seeds come to fruition, then they're sharing it with their mommies and daddies or their brothers and sisters, and then they're sharing it with whoever else who's Ethiopian. And we have the opportunity within like a 2-block radius of our home to do Ethiopian families, Kenyan families, Hispanic families, Asian families. So God has really been using us where we're at, and we're so thankful and just excited to see what else he brings to us. So thanks for letting us share.
Awesome. Let's give them a round of applause. Thank you. That's powerful. And just shows you how simple, right? That coming and seeing, that invitation, just having your eyes open, just looking around, seeing the needs. And there are needs in all of our neighborhoods. One of the last things I want to share about just Jesus' first invitation is that it really is an invitation. It's not an obligation. I want to put some of us into a state of peace as we attempt to put this into practice. That Jesus never forced anyone to follow him. Jesus never forced anybody to make him their Lord and Savior, right? And neither do we. Right? We see examples, and there are probably more that happened during Jesus' life, where Jesus issued an invitation, but they didn't say yes. Right? You think of the rich young man, who Jesus said, "Hey, come and follow me. Come and learn from me." And he said, "No." You see Jesus pouring years investing into one of his apostles, who later would abandon him. We read in John chapter 6 where Jesus talks about how he is the bread of life. And as he's sharing about this, he witnesses a mass exodus of people who are starting to follow him. We're checking him out at that point. Here's what John 6 verse 66 says. Is after this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. Which, on a side note, isn't it interesting that that falls on 6, verse 66, right? That's the verse that happens to be given towards people who decide no longer to follow Jesus. Maybe a coincidence, but here's the point. The point is that Jesus is the master evangelist and disciple maker, and yet people said no to him. Why would we expect anything more of ourselves? See, it is not our responsibility as disciples to force anybody to do anything, right? We are not to hand out mandates or ultimatums. We're to hand out invitations. And this is our responsibility. If we look in Romans chapter 10, it lays this out nicely for us. It says, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And how then will they call on him whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent?" See, here's what we see. It says, God sends his servants. His servants preach. People hear. Hearers believe. Believers call on the Lord. And everyone who calls on the Lord is saved. I want to read an excerpt, and I'm putting it up here so it sticks a little bit, from a book called Radical by David Platt, and he writes this. Says, "Now look back at this progression and ask one question. Is there any place where this plan can break down? Think about it. Obviously, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. There's no breakdown there. Everyone who believes will call. Many will hear, not all, but many will believe. People will hear the gospel when we preach it to them, and God is most definitely still in the business of sending his servants. That means there's only one potential breakdown in this progression: when servants of God do not preach the gospel to all peoples." See, when we choose to invest and invite, what we are saying is that we are willing, Lord, to make disciples, beginning with non-Christians. And this is a call for us individually, and this is a call for us corporately. We need to be in the business of making snowmen, all right? And so, that footwork. Oh, I introduce to you how we, as a leadership of this church, incorporate this come and see invitation into the life of our church. And it's through what we would say is the worship gathering. Right? What is the worship gathering? Here's the purpose of the worship gathering: is to encounter the truth of the gospel. So why do we come here every week? Why do we invite you to come back to discover Jesus. I mean, why, if you were a student, does Wednesday nights not count? Why does Wednesday nights youth group not replace the Sunday morning gathering? If you're an adult, why does your ABF or your midweek life group not replace our come and see worship gathering? Well, to answer that, we need to look at our core values and our key attributes. Our core values are proclamation of the word in its various forms. It is intergenerational gathering involving celebration, edification. In other words, we are building each other up in Christ and in service. And then our third core value of the worship gathering is maximizing the gifts and abilities of the body to minister to one another. That's why we invite you to come back every single Sunday. That's what we need to be about. And then key attributes. I mean, what does it actually look like? What are the functions that we would do in this gathering? Among others, music and art, the reading and proclaiming of scripture, prayer, communion, baptism, tithing, assimilation, right? Relationships, incorporating one another into the body. So here's what we have a responsibility. We have a responsibility to allow anybody and everyone to come and walk the path of a disciple. And people enter, and we are all at different points in that. We have to continue to usher people and allow for that in a simple way. And so the worship gathering is one of our three primary environments that we believe will help you and everyone who comes to live out the mission of First Federated Church. It's not necessarily the most important, but it is important. And next week, we'll get to Jesus' second invitation and our second environment. But first, here's what I want to do. I want to wrap up with two really quick final invitations. Some of you may be in this prolonged come and see period of your life, where you've kind of checked out Jesus. You might have been considering Jesus. Maybe you've been showing up here learning about Jesus, but you've never made a decision of what that means for your life. For me, that lasted months. Maybe for you, it's lasted that much or longer. Perhaps your parents have helped make a decision for you. Perhaps your spouse likes to think that you made a decision, but you have not. And so here's what I want to encourage you. If you're in that come and see period of your life where you're discovering Jesus, I would love to have a conversation with you. Not forced, not an obligation, just an invitation to talk that out. If you are interested in that, then here's what I'd like to do. We referenced this earlier, but in your bulletin is this connection card. I would ask that you would write your name, put your phone number down, and somewhere put crucial conversation, because here's that ultimate invitation. It's for you to have a crucial conversation about who Jesus is and what that could mean for your life. And then you can hand that to me after the service, and I'd love to follow up as soon as possible, find a time where we can get together and talk that through. Some of you are there. Some of us are at a point where we are following Christ, right? We have moved beyond the come and see. We are at the follow me, and here's my challenge for you, is are you willing to start the disciple-making process with unsaved people? Are you willing to issue invitations and investment to those who do not know the Lord? If so, I hope that you take something of what you've gained today and begin to put it into practice. Provoke curiosity. Just please, do not be a stranger to sinners. Do not be an acquaintance to strangers or to sinners. Please, 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 be a friend to sinners. In your home, in your neighborhood, in your workplace, be a friend of sinners and invest and invite. Invest and invite. Let's pray. Father, how much you've invested in us, those of us in the faith. God, we all have a story. God, a story of you investing in us. God, you sending people to invest and invite into our life. God, may we give you thanks for those anointed moments in our past. God, I pray that you would send us out from here. God, that church would truly begin as we leave here, that we put into practice those things we have learned, that which you have trained us to do, God. God, may we not feel the pressures of having to be successful, but God, may we just be willing to go out and issue invitation. That we would prioritize the people that you prioritized, Father. May your work of making disciples impact us individually and corporately through this body and beyond. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.